All right, so a couple of lectures ago, we began thinking about this question of given data that lives in many subspaces, how do we cluster the data and how do we find their subspaces, their dimensions, how many they are, and so on and so forth. And we discussed already an algorithm called K-subspaces that is able to do this task. So K-subspaces assumes that you know how many subspaces are present, and assumes that you know the dimension of every subspace. And then it follows an iterative procedure. Given an initial clustering, you do PCA on every group. Then once you have a basis for every subspace, you can use that basis to assign each point to the closest subspace. And so by iterating between subspace learning and point assignments, because you're minimizing an objective function and doing alternating minimization, we argued that you eventually converge. We argued that you converge in a finite number of steps, and but you are only guaranteed to converge to a local minimum. And so to address the local minimum problem, we said we need some good initialization, and we discussed initialization techniques for PCA. We said the mean of every PCA can be obtained maybe from randomly selecting data points, and the basis maybe can be obtained by looking at local neighborhoods and doing PCA locally to initialize. And I said that that still won't guarantee you anything, and so the common practice is that you do this with multiple initializations and you pick the best. So what were the advantages of K-subspaces? Very nice, simple, intuitive. It directly relies on PCA, which we already know. And the extra step is just assignment, which is done based on a distance. So from that perspective, very simple. But what are the minuses? Exactly what I just said. Non-convex, depends on initialization, no guarantees of getting the correct clustering. And I need to know the number of subspaces and their dimensions beforehand. So what we're going to explore now is whether we can use spectral clustering to do the clustering of subspaces. So as you might remember, the key idea behind spectral clustering is the following. We build a graph, so here's some data points. The idea is to connect points to other points based on similarity. And ideally, we would like that similarity. So I'm going to define that similarity here as, let me call it, or affinity. I would like to build an affinity I, A, I, J, that ideally is 1 if I and J, if X, I, or if this, if X, I belongs to same subspace as XJ and 0 otherwise. That's what we would like ideally. And we already studied spectral clustering and we demonstrated that when you have a perfect affinity, and by perfect affinity I meant exactly that, that it connects only points to their other points from the same group, what did we show? We showed that the Laplacian, the eigenvectors of the Laplacian, give you the clustering of the data points. Right? That's what we showed. So we would like to do something like that, and the question is, how do we go about connecting pairs of points to define an affinity? The issue is that we don't know the subspaces. So a priori, there is no way to tell whether the two points are in the same group or not. What did we do in spectral clustering? So in spectral clustering, what we did was to say that Aij is going to be e to the minus the distance between xi and xj squared. Well, maybe normalized. Okay? That's what we did in spectral clustering. So what that meant was that if these two points are close to each other, then you get a high affinity. If these two points are far from each other, you get a bad affinity. And so the issue is that here, I could have, for example, this point and that point. Right, those two guys are very far. And so if I do an affinity that is built from distances, I'll get zero. Conversely, I could have, you know, this is the intersection, I could have this point in this subspace and that point in the other subspace. Now the points are very close to each other, yet they are in different groups. But if I do an affinity like the one described over there, then I will be forced to put them together. And so the problem is that when you have a union of subspaces and those subspaces intersect, okay, near the intersection, you're going to have maybe, potentially, many points that will get connected with a very strong affinity, yet they belong to different groups. Unlike the classical situation of spectral clustering, right? From spectral clustering, when we were looking, right, all of these guys get connected. So it was okay to have a few wrong connections, right? But if you remember the theorem that we studied, it was a small perturbation of the weights causes a small perturbation of the Laplacian, and that causes a small perturbation of the eigenvectors, based on which I do the segmentation. And so the issue is here, you know, a small perturbation meant that the weight across groups needed to be small. The issue is that here I could have all of these pairs of points with very large weights. And so the perturbation might not be small. And so spectral clustering might fail. Okay? Nonetheless, that could be a first approach. Just do spectral clustering as we did so far. And in fact, if you try it, you should see that it should fail. So the question is, how do we define what I'm going to call a subspace affinity? How do we define an affinity that is appropriate for this subspace clustering? And so what I would argue first is that it cannot be done. From pairs of points. Why it cannot be done from pairs of points? So let me illustrate that with a picture. So suppose, for the sake of simplicity, that I have two lines which, or actually let me do one case where I can do it and one case where I cannot. So suppose that I have two lines through the origin, and this is the origin. Suppose now that I have a collection of points here in the lines. Okay. So those are going to be that's my data set. And I would like to tell for any pair of points, are they in the same subspace or are they not? Okay. So suppose that I pick, for the sake of argument, these two points, so that could be xi, that could be xj, and they are in the same subspace in this case. So how would I know that they're in the same subspace? How could I write down a metric that tells me whether they're in the same subspace or not? So in this particular case, it actually can be done. And let me tell you how I would do it. You could just compute the dot product between xi and xj. Normalize it, right? And what does the dot product normalize gives? The angle, or the cosine of the angle between the two, right? So this is the cosine of the angle between I and J, okay? And let me take the absolute value just to ensure, you know, if I have one point from there and one point from there, I'd like the angle to be always positive. So if it is 0 or 180, I want it to be 0. Okay. So that's why I take the absolute value. So Like this is really the acute angle between any two points. So what property, if I define the affinity Aij to be this, what happens? If two points are in the same subspace, what happens? In the same line in this case?
Zero.
This is, someone said zero. Any other options? What is this, the value of this affinity?
One.
Okay, so this is equal to one if xi and j in the same subspace. Okay? What if xi and xj are in different subspaces right now?
Not one.
What do you get? Not one. That's a good answer.
It's correct.
Any answer that is more precise?
Less than one.
Huh? Less than one. That's also true. But more precisely, what do I get? So let's say this angle was alpha. That's a fixed angle because it's the angle between the lines. So what do I get?
Cosine of alpha.
Right. Which is, of course, less than alpha. Okay. So this immediately tells you the following, that if the two lines were orthogonal to each other, I would get 1 and 0, right? And that will give you a perfect affinity. If now the angle is smaller, still, you can distinguish it. So this affinity will not be bad at all. This affinity, if you put it in the matrix over the data points, it'll be 1 everywhere, and then cosine alpha here, and 1 and cosine alpha. Right? So you will get, so every point will be connected to everybody. The points in the same subspace will have a strong connection of 1, and the points in different subspaces will still be connected, but with a cosine of alpha. So what do you expect? Well, eventually it will probably fail, right? Once the alpha gets close to zero, eventually this will fail. But with the alpha closer to 90 degrees, it's probably going to work very well. So there you have an example where if the data lie in two lines, then you can apply spectral clustering if you're very clever as to how you define your affinity. So let me now give you another example. So suppose now we have two planes. And again, the same idea. I've got my points everywhere. Okay? So can I do the same? If I just take any two points and compute the angle, would I be able to tell whether they're in the same plane or in different planes? Yes or no? Well, let's take two points in one plane. What are the angles? Well, principle, it can be anything, right? Right? Any angle would go, and sure, I'm restricting it to be acute, so it's going to be any angle between 0 and 90 degrees. Now, if I look at, you know, if I go now two subspaces and I take two points, what are the angles that am I going to get? In principle, I could get any angle also because I could choose this point anywhere I want, and I could choose this point anywhere I want. So depending on the choice, I'll get any angle. In fact, if I get them close to the intersection, I could get zero angles, right? Because I could choose, you know, if this is the origin, let's say this is the origin, right? I could choose one vector, right? Let's say that's one, and then I have here is another. So actually, or any two points in the intersection of the two, I can get them to have zero angle. So the angle between points won't make it here. Okay. So what could we do? So the fact of the matter is that there is no way to do it just out of two points, which is where I conjecture. And I need to look at three points, not two points. So how can I do it with three points? Anyone can guess? So let's say, for example, I consider here xi, xj, and xk. Maybe I should plot them slightly differently. Give me a second. Let me put x I here, another there, and another there. So this is one vector, this is another vector, and this is another vector. X I, x j, and x a. Okay? So in this particular case, let me consider the cross product between xi and xj, and then dot product with xk. What does that give me?
Zero.
Zero. Why is it zero? Why is it zero? Yeah, because when I do the cross product, I get the normal to the plane, and then I do dot product with any other point in the plane, I get zero. Okay. Is it always zero for any 3 points? Or only for any 3 points in the same plane? Okay, for any 3 points in the same plane, it's true. But if the xk was here, for instance, would I get zero or not? Yes or no? Excuse me?
Well,
let's say the xk is this guy. Right? Remember, I'm going to give you a data set. You have no clue which point belongs to which group. You're trying to build an affinity. And I'm saying, can we look at 3 points and build an affinity among those 3 points? What property do we want for an affinity among 3 points? The same idea. We would like that affinity on 3 points to be 1 or large if the 3 points are in the same group. But if I just pick 3 points at random, they could be in two different places. Right? So I think we agree that if I define this affinity, A, I, J, K, or maybe again, I'm going to take the actual value, that will be, in this particular case, it's not an affinity, but this would be actually zero. We shouldn't define it as an affinity. Let me call it distance. But what am I computing when xi, xj, and xk are arbitrary points in 3D space? What is this? The volume spanned by the 3 points. So if I plot xi, xj, and xk, right, this forms a cube, or not a cube, but I don't remember anymore how this is called. Okay. And the volume of that affine deformation of the cube is given by exactly this product. Remember that from high school or probably high school? Or at the latest, it must have been calculus 3. Okay? So, this thing has the following property. I'm just going to write it. This is 0 if I, J, K is in the same plane and strictly positive if otherwise. Okay, that's a property of this term. Okay. And so, naturally, I could define an affinity A, I, J, K. Now I could do maybe E to the minus this one. I cross X, J, transfer. And now I'm back in business. But I'm back in business not entirely because I don't have anything for pair of points. I have now for the three triplets. And all of the spectral clustering stuff that we talked about was based on graphs. And when we had graphs, we had edges between two points. We never talked about super edges between among three points, right? So a key question is, even if I had this multi-way affinity, or three-way affinity in this particular case, how would I use it to actually do the clustering? Is the next step. So, one possibility is that I could define an Aij, maybe by summing won't quite work. I would like to build something based on two points such that.
What if you take the minimum?
The minimum?
Take the minimum over all k.
That's a great idea. Perfect. That's exactly what I want. So this is n of these k. Okay, maybe I should change notation. I'm going to call this tilde, and that's going to be the affinity. Okay? That would look great. All right, so the bottom line is, okay, good, I can do it. So I can cluster planes now with spectral clustering. I'll just consider all triplets of points. I will compute the volume of each triplet, and I will do e to the minus the volume. And I will use that as an affinity. And then I'll take the best affinity. For each pair of points, I'll maximize over the third one for it. And now I can apply spectral clustering. The problem is that now I need to do n choose 3 triplets. Right? Before my affinities in fact are always n by n. But this A, the A tilde, this guy, this A tilde is now N by N by N. Okay? So this you did not learn in high school, but you might learn in the future. This is a tensor, it's a three-way tensor, which is an extension of matrices to higher order. Okay, so now I have a three-way tensor, and I have a procedure for reducing that tensor to a matrix. But now it's n cubed. It's still polynomial, that'd be okay. But you know, that's just for planes in R3. So how do I do this in general? So suppose now that I have subspaces of dimension d. So, by analogy, right, I need to consider now, I'm going to define an Ai tilde, and I need to choose I1, I2, dot, I, okay, how many points do I need to choose now in order to have a meaningful quantum? So for lines, I chose a pair of points, and I could directly define the affinity. For planes, I needed 3 points to define a meaningful affinity. So if I have a subspace of dimension D, what will I do? D plus 1 point. So I will select as a B, I set D plus 1. So I have I set D plus 1. And now I need to compute something like the volume. So I'm just going to write that here. And compute the volume of the point xi1, xi d plus 1. OK, so I'm going to form a matrix with those points. By the way, if I do it in between parentheses, it's over here. This quantity is the same thing as the determinant of the matrix whose columns are xi, xj, xk, right? And then I need to take the absolute value. You guys remember that from linear algebra? And the cross product dot with a third is the same thing as just, in fact, that's the way we manually compute cross products, in fact, right? We make a 3x3 matrix, we put I, j, k in the first row, and then the other two vectors. But if we put 3 vectors in the rows, then we get exactly this problem. The same thing is with the columns, because the determinant of A or the determinant of A transpose is the same. All right, so that's what I'm saying here, that this is just the determinant. Okay. So more generally, what are we really saying here? I mean, what is the generic principle? Is it really the angles? Is it really this volume? Or what is the generic principle? That I have subspaces of dimension little d. I select d plus 1 points. What needs to happen if they're in the same subspace? D plus 1 points, they're all in a subspace of dimension d. What must happen to those d plus 1 points?
They rank d.
It must be rank d, or they must be linearly dependent, right? If they are in the situation, so consider those exactly those two situations, two different subspaces, and I select, let's say, half and half, like some points in subspace one, some points in subspace two, and I have d plus one of them. The generic case is that they're going to have rank d plus one. Only if they're in the same subspace, they'll have rank d. So what I expect, in fact, instead of even the volume, is that I expect that the rank of xi1, xi d plus 1, this rank should be d if xi1 through xi d plus 1 are in the same subspace. And d plus 1 other. That's a property that is always true, right? And that tells you why I need at least d plus 1 of them, right? Because if I just put 2, if you just pick 2 points at random, what is the rank of the matrix formed by those 2 points? It's always 2, right? You cannot distinguish. If you just look at 2 points, you cannot distinguish whether they're in the same subspace or not. The rank is always 2. It's only when you have d plus 1 of them that you get for the first, even if you do d, right? If you pick d points, the rank will always be d. So you need d plus 1 to start distinguishing. Except that the rank is not so great, because what I really liked, what did we want here? The affinity must be 1 or small. 1 or 0, I mean. Distance, when we deal with distances, the distance needs to be 0 or positive. The rank is not a great quantity because it's either d or d plus 1. Okay? That's why the volume is a better quantity, because the volume is 0 if the points are, how do you say, beyond collinear, coplanar, and then co. any of our native speakers? Can we go beyond planes? Okay, I'll say coplanar, but I mean that they lie in the same subset. Okay. So the volume of these d plus 1 points will be zero if they're in the same subspace, and non-zero otherwise. So in fact, you didn't correct me, but what I need to do again is e 2 minus the volume. Now, the rank story suggests that maybe I could use the rank, but what's going to be the reality? Using the rank is never great because the data is always noisy. So maybe, and this has not been done, by the way, but maybe people could use the nuclear norm. The issue is that we're distinguishing between D and D plus 1 with noise or with nuclear norms. It's not too sensitive, right? And in fact, the volume might not be entirely sensitive either, because if I now got all the points in the same plane and the volume is zero, but you know, I just start moving 1 point slightly, the volume is going to be epsilon, right? It's only when this point gets really away, right? But actually, that's good because we need to be measuring near coplanarity as well. So the rank is the exact and precise and rigorous condition, and that's the condition that really tells you and convinces you that you need D plus 1 point. But it's not enough. We really need to do this. Okay, so good. So we're going to have this affinity, for instance. And now, again, we face the same trouble. Here I have triplets. And now I have, I cannot apply spectral clustering to a multi-way affinity with D plus 1 collections. Right. I need to reduce it to 2. So how can we reduce it to 2? And now I remember, so this suggestion of the minimum was a good one, but actually the classical way to do this is slightly different. The idea is going to be as follows. How am I going to define the affinity between I've got the point I there, I've got the point J there, okay? And now this guy is going to be connected to many others, right? Right? And when I connect it to all of them, I'm going to generate this affinity, A tilde, that connects point I to other D points. Right? So that is the affinity between the I point and other little d points, so that I have d plus 1 in total. By analogy, for the j point, I can build affinities. Maybe I'm going to make it like that. And then this is another one, and so on and so forth. I can also build affinities for this guy. That's going to be a j, and then j1. In general, right? I could be connecting it to any other. Right? But the idea is going to be as follows. If we choose the connected neighborhoods of the 2 points to be the same, and then sum over all possible connections, then I'm going to be able to eliminate. So in particular, let me write it down. What we're going to do is define aij to be the sum I1, ib of ai, I1, ib, aj, I1, ib. Maybe it's way easier to understand here, so let me do it for the case of 3. What we're going to do is that we've got point I, and that point I gets connected to 2 points, right? In this particular case, we needed always triplets. That first connection is I1, that second connection is I2, right? Because I'm exploring all possible triplets, the point I will get connected with I1 and I2. But likewise for the J. Okay? So in a sense, it's like I've got this point and I've got that point connected to two others, and now sum over all possible two extra connections that you have, and sum the products of the affinity. Because this in a sense, actually, maybe now I explain you the intuition. This says how well connected is point I to these other D points. How well connected are these D points to the J point? So the product of the two, right? If this point is perfectly well connected to that guy, it would have an affinity 1. If J is perfectly well connected to those D points, it will have an affinity 1. So the product of these two would be 1. And now I sum over all possible choices. Obviously, you might want to normalize this quantity by dividing by this combinatorial number of possible selections of D points. Okay? Agree? That's a way to eliminate and reuse the tensor to a matrix in this case. Good, we did it. So that's how we can solve the problem. So now you just go home and compute volumes of D+1 points and call spectral clustering algorithm. If you go and do that, the only thing that's going to happen is that you're going to click enter after you debug it and it's working. And then you're going to patiently wait for the results for a very long time. Why? Two things are happening here. First, I need to generate this matrix, right? This calculation requires n choose D+1. Right? Okay? So this is going to grow like n to the d, right? So something like O of n to the D+1. Right? So sure, this is very good for planes and lines, maybe for three dimensions, but eventually, if n is a million points, right, this is it. And if you have just 10 dimensions, like in faces, right, this is already a million to the 10. Just to generate the triplets. Now you need to evaluate the volume for each case, and now you need to... All right, I already got tired with the explanation. My calculations. Then you need to sum, and you need to sum over all possible choices as well. So this is beautiful, this is perfect, but this will require just a lot of calculation. So working on how to make this efficient, and how to sample, and the key idea is going to be, don't generate all possible and choose the cases. Can you generate a small fraction of them and still get a good thing? And that's where research is ongoing on this topic. Okay, so the advantages. The first advantage is that it's clean, it's elegant, and theoretically, I'm gonna write here, that's the job. Maybe you should just write correct. That one. So those are the big pluses of this plan. But the big minuses is computational complexity. There is yet another minus. And what is that minus? Anyone can tell me? What happens if I had subspaces of different dimensions? What do I do? What happens if I don't know D? Even if they are of the same dimension. Would it be sensitive to getting the wrong D? Well, if I underestimate it, right, it's like the in the run case, right, if I put D or D minus 1 or D minus 2, I can't distinguish anything at all because they all have the same rank. So by analogy, the volumes would all be comparable. They're all full rank, so I always get full volume. If I overestimate D, yes, I'll get the rank. The rank would be either D or D plus 1. But I might get in trouble as well, right? Because if I have two planes of dimension little d, if I select 2D point or 2D plus something point, eventually I'll lose rank as well. Okay? So having is not only I need to know D, but knowing D is kind of critical to get this right. Okay. So need to know D. And all dimensions need to be equal. Yeah, I actually don't know what would you do if the dimensions are different. Right, because you will need different D's. You will need different D's for each subset. So in a sense, you would need to, if the dimensions are different, you would need to know those dimensions, the two of them, but you will need to know the dimension for that point so that you know how many neighbors to put for that point. So that's the trouble. So even if they were known, you would be in trouble. So it's best just in the case where they're all equal. So that's another restriction. Okay. Maybe the last one, but actually this can be fixed. So I'm going to put a plus and a minus here, which is the normalization. You know, what we did in the first example, we didn't just take the dot product. We actually normalized it. And if we don't normalize it, the dot product wouldn't have worked. Okay? So it was good. We got the cosine of the angles. In this case, we didn't normalize, and I didn't argue and I didn't tell you why, but in fact, it may be better to actually normalize. Right? Because what if the points are scaled? This distance is going to change. Like, you know, in reality, this distance is never going to be zero, is it? Right? And you want some level of invariance. So you could, for example, divide these by the norm of that, the norm of that, and the norm of that. So by analogy, the volume of d plus 1 points will be of degree d plus 1 in a certain way, right? Like the volume of a cube is something to the cube. When you have a subspace of dimension little d, you're going to get something to the d power. And so likewise here, we're going to have d plus 1 points, so we're going to get something to the d plus 1. So if I divide by the norm of each one of the points, I make it invariant to scale changes. So if the cube is small versus the cube is huge, that's not wrong. So in fact, just to give full credit, this normalization, there is a way to do people who studied this problem correctly. And I should give the citation. So Gilad Lerman studied this question, and what he came up with was, I don't remember the precise formula, so don't believe what I'm going to write, but what he did was something along the lines of what I just described. So you have some formula for computing the volume of these d plus 1 points, and you divide by, for example, the product of the norms. Okay? And that way we make it invariant. And what this thing has a name, and in fact it's related to the curvature. Okay? And he calls it spectral curvature. Why is it related to the curvature? So in fact, the way to think about it is, another way to think about it is the following. If I have a plane, what is the curvature of the plane? Anyone knows?
Zero.
Zero. Right? So in fact, another measure would have been just to compute curvature. How do I compute curvature from sample data points? Okay, maybe that's a little bit more complicated. For curves, you might remember if you took calculus 3 that there is a way to compute the curvature of a curve. Right? It involves some derivatives of the parametrization of the curve somehow. And somehow those derivatives, actually, if I remember correctly, something like the cross product between the first derivative cross the second derivative and stuff like that. And so you could discretize for curves. So you could say the first derivative is the difference between two points, and then the second derivative, there is a formula to discretize those derivatives, right? So there are ways of computing curvature as a function of the points, and in fact, it's very much related to that formula. The correct formula, you can find it in the book, but it's very much related to the volume of the point and normalizing a circle, right? Okay? So that's why this is sort of a generalization of curvature from lines to planes to, more broadly, subspaces of any dimension, with the expectation that curvature is zero when the d points or the d plus one points that are used to compute the curvature are selected from the same subspace. But that curvature is going to be non-zero when you choose points from different subspaces because you no longer have a plane. Okay? And so this method is, the whole method is called spectral curvature classification. And this method consists of the following steps, and I'll just summarize it now. So step number one is compute A tilde. So yeah, summarize, compute A tilde that belongs to R n by n by da 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 da, and this is d plus 1 times. Okay. Compute that tensor, or that affinity tensor, as defined in there. It's going to be exactly the formula for at the very top. It's e to the minus the volume, but maybe the volume is normal. So in fact, like right here, a I 1, I d plus 1, tilde. Okay. Compute that. This is exactly what goes into this. Okay. Second, compute A. And A is now just an affinity, n by n. How? Well, I think I wrote the formula. Exactly that A that is right there. And three, apply spectral class. And this is the first method, the first spectral clustering method for subspaces. And this might be around 2008 or 2009, 2010 maybe. So let me discuss a second method. This is, I think it's 2006. So this is called local subspace. So what is very interesting is that this method was developed earlier, yet it's better to teach it after. The reason it's better to teach it after is because what is the key, you know, I already wrote down the disadvantages of SCC. And one of the key ones is computational complexity, this idea that you need to consider all possible neighborhoods of size D plus 1. So what Yang and Polyface said was the following thing. They said, well, sure, I've got a problem here near the intersection. Points come from multiple subspaces. But in general, if I have a point and I look at the neighbors of that point, not always, but in many cases, it could happen that if I consider only these points and their neighbors, and I fit a subspace to that local neighbor, in this particular case, I'll get a normal, let's say V1, that is right there. Okay? In fact, let me call that point xi, and I'm going to call this the normal of associated with the neighborhood of point xi. Okay? I'm doing this for the planes, but this generalizes. So now, if I consider another set of points, another point here, and I consider it's near its neighbors, and I consider a local neighborhood, and I compute for that point xj, right? I do PCA locally, and I compute, say, the normal to that plane, I'm going to get b associated with xj. So, what if I consider two local neighborhoods that correspond to the same subspace? So for the sake of argument, I'll look at that, and maybe I'll have another neighborhood here. And I can do the norm. What is going to be, for example, the dot product between bxi and bxj? Again, absolute value. So if xi and xj are in the same subspace, right, and their local neighborhoods are not contaminated, if I get very lucky that those local neighborhoods, all of the points are in the same group, what's going to happen? What is the dot product between these two normal vectors? When they xi and xj are in the same subspace. One. So this is going to be 1 if xi and xj are in the same subspace. But I'm going to add the caveat here. And the neighborhood of I and the neighborhood of j are, you know, pure. So this is the neighborhood of point I, and this is the neighborhood of point j. So if two points xi and j are pure neighborhoods, and compute the normals, I'm going to get a dot for 1 because the normals are going to be the same, right? Right? I'm going to get perfect normals, the data is not contaminated, the neighborhoods are pure, I can estimate them, they should be the same normal, no matter what local neighborhood I consider. What if, now, they are in different subspaces? What's going to happen? What's going to happen with the normals? Okay, I know you're going to say less than 1. You know, you learned something from the first half of the class at this point. What should it be? Cosine. Okay, that was the cosine of the angle between the lines. What's going to happen now?
Oh my god.
High school geometry. The dot product between the normals, the two planes, is equal to the cosine of the angle between the planes or not? Right? That's high school geometry. All right, so this is going to be the cosine of the angle between the subspace, or in this case the plane, corresponding to xi, and the subspace corresponding to xj. Right? That's for planes in R3. So I'm talking planes in R3. The dot product between the normals of the planes is the same thing as the cosine of the angle between the planes. Again, this is either in different subspaces, but the neighborhoods also need to be here. If xi and xj are in different subspaces and neighborhoods appear. So that's good. It actually is almost like the case of lines. Except that there's a third case, right? What is the third case? That the neighborhoods might not be pure. Right? I might, and in that case, I'm just gonna get some random number that I cannot control. And so then I'll get something. Well, something less than or equal to 1 probably, right? I don't know. If neighborhoods are not pure. Okay? So what this says really is I'm going to have a connection strength of 1 for points that are in the same subspace. A connection strength clearly smaller than 1 for points in different subspaces, provided that the neighborhoods are pure, and then I have no control over the neighborhoods that are not pure. So if I have a data set that I'm really lucky, that it happens to be the case that there is not much stuff around the intersection, this will probably have very few wrong connections and will do a good job. But if I am if my data has a lot of points near the intersection, this method would likely fail. Okay? But the method has the huge advantage, right? How many do I need to compute and choose D? So what is the complexity? I go from N choose D to what? To compute the affinity.
N squared.
I need to look at each point.
Each pair or each pair.
But I need to compute the k nearest neighbors, for example. K needs to be at least D, I think. Right? So I need to compute, first I need to compute all distances to do nearest neighbors. So at least N squared for computing all the distances. But then, once I've computed all distances, I have the neighbors. For each data point, I need to do PCA, right? Before I get started. So what's the complexity of doing PCA? Well, it's the SVD, computing the SVD of the data, right? What's the complexity of computing the SVD of the data? If I have a D by N matrix, what's the complexity of computing the SVD of that matrix? If it was squared, if it was n by n, what would be the complexity of the SVD?
Oh my god.
N cubed. Right. So if the matrix was squared, this would be like n cubed. Because I'm taking a point and it's k nearest neighbors, and the dimension of the data might be large, capital D, when you have essentially matrices that are not squared, like D by N, it could be either D times N squared or D squared times N, whichever the smallest, because you can always permute it or transpose it before you get started to do the smallest calculation, right? So roughly is linear in the largest dimension and quadratic on the smallest dimension. Okay. So what we can do here is we will need to do n squared, so that's one part, but we also need to do d times d squared. Okay, this is all O's. We need to do PCA at each point. Once we are done with PCA, we need to compute angles between subspaces. In this particular case of normals, that's just dot products. And since I need to do dot products, there are n squared of them, like for every pair of points. So it's the same. I don't need to modify the n squared. But the next question is, how do I do this for subspaces that are not planes? Okay, so that's the next question. So, well, so it's sort of, where is it? Okay, here's my affinity. Well, how do I generalize that to beyond planes? That's the question. So here's what we're going to do. So the question is how to define a local subspace affinity, which is in fact the name of the method. So in a sense, it's like I've got two subspaces that were estimated locally, and I would like to measure whether they are very similar, namely they are both versions of the same subspace, or whether they are very different. Okay? So what we can do is the following. I'm going to have point I, and I'm going to have the nearest neighbors from that point, right? That's what we do. So these are, for example, the k nearest neighbors. And in particular, if you know the dimension, you can choose k to be the dimension, right? But you could choose more points, because we're going to do PCA, and so we are always going to keep So now what I'm going to do is that I'm going to apply PCA to this, and once I apply PCA, I'm going to get mu, I'm going to denote it sub I, and u sub I. In particular, I'm going to get more things, but the key things is that I get the subspace. Right? I get my parameterization of the subspace estimated from point I and its k nearest neighbor. By analogy, I'm going to have as j with its own neighbors, and again, I can take k equal d if I knew it. And I'm going to apply PCA, and I'm going to get mu j and u j, which is the local subspace estimated around point x j. So what I need now is some distance between these two subspaces. Okay. So you might remember that if this is a subspace, I can compute the distance from the point to the subspace, right? How do I compute the distance from a point to a subspace? If this subspace is parameterized by mu and u, and this point is x, how do I compute the distance from this to that? Remember? Lecture number 5? Is x, well, I subtract mu. So mu might be a point here, so I subtract it. And then I need to project it onto the orthogonal complement. So it's I minus u transpose, and then the norm. That was what we minimized for PCA, didn't we? sum of the square distances after we found the optimal low dimensional representation, we got that. That's the distance from a point, x, to a subspace parameterized by mu and u. So one way to build a distance between two subspaces here is simply as follows. I could say, aha, maybe I'm going to say the distance from this point in that subspace to this subspace. That might be one. So I could compute the distance between subspace I and subspace j that I'm going to define. It could be defined as identity minus ui, ui transpose. And maybe I'm going to do mu j times ui to and let me put a square because we love the sum of the squares. So why not? And now I need to symmetrize, right? Because that is effectively the distance from one point in subspace J to subspace I. Now I could do the distance from one point in subspace I be mu I minus mu J. So pictorially, all we're doing is this is one subspace, this is maybe another subspace, okay? I have the mu, maybe let me draw it there, let's say that this is mu I. I'm just computing that distance, the distance from mu I to subspace j. That is this guy. This guy is this. And now, let's say that this was, for the sake of argument, mu well, almost. It's like this. You could define it in various different ways, but the key idea, in fact, maybe I chose one point here, so maybe this is not a great choice. You could make it better. But the key idea really is that you've got to pick one point in the subspace and compute the distance to the other, and vice versa. In fact, if you have two lines in 3D, right, what is the distance between the two lines? One possibility is to, you know, they don't intersect, but they are nearly crossing, I could pick the minimum distance. That's sort of the idea that I'm trying to convey here, that there are ways of computing distances between subspaces. And that's one possibility. And all I'm trying to say is that if the two PCAs that I compute, they're local, they're computed in different regions, but they are supposed to come from the same subspace, so they should be very close to each other. Ideally, they should be equal. If they're equal, the difference of the means will be zero, and the basis will be, even if I make the mistake that I don't pick the same means, okay, this will be non-zero, but once I project it onto the orthogonal complement, I'll get a zero. Okay, so I hope now you are convinced that this is a second method that simply says the following, and this is the summary of the steps. Pick every point, compute your k nearest neighbors, compute PCA locally, and now compare these local PCAs to build an affinity. This is a distance. Obviously, what we're going to do is that the affinity ij is the same thing as before, e to the minus dij squared. This is dij. And now you just apply spectral clustering to this affinity. What's the great thing of this method? Computational complexity is not too bad. I'm clearly way better than the other. Is it guaranteed to work? Not quite, because I already explained it. I could have a lot of contaminated neighborhoods, it will depend. Does it suffer from my needing to know the dimension little d? Maybe not. Where do I need the d? Well, if I knew d, I could choose the k nearest neighbors. But if I don't know d and the dimensions are different, what could I do? I could just choose more nearest neighbors. If the k is overestimated right now, there should be no problem. right? Because the PCA will reduce from k to the correct one. In fact, I could potentially estimate the dimension because I'm going to consider a point, k nearest neighbors, and I do PCA. I could do PCA with model selection and actually get the dimension locally. Maybe not all points will agree on the same dimension, but right, that's life with real data. But this method is not critically sensitive to knowing the dimension precisely a priori, or less sensitive than the previous one, and doesn't require the dimensions to be equal anymore, because at every point locally, you can estimate its own PCA with its own dimension. Okay? So those are advantages of the previous one, and these advantages come at the cost of we are not guaranteed to be correct anymore. All right, to be continued. Have a good weekend.